rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 29 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the delight of chatting with Carla Jones. Carla is the Business Development Consultant and Digital Marketing Director at SSG Business Solutions, where they provide custom business and digital marketing growth strategies for the entrepreneur, small and medium-sized startup, and existing businesses. Their focus is organization and operations growth, web analytics, and social media marketing and management. They take a holistic approach in their organizational assessments and methodologies for the businesses that they serve. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Carla Jones. Carla, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me today.
So you are a business development consultant and digital marketing director, but no one starts at the top and we all have a story. So take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Okay. I actually got bit by the bug of digital and social media marketing in 2013 by happenstance. Clearly was not something I even dabbled in. I mean, here I am. I call myself a boom-lennial, a boomer in a millennial's world. Mm-hmm. And it just so happened that I received a phone call from a former coworker who was now consulting for a major manufacturer and was looking for some support in the beauty industry side because they were looking at developing a hair care product specifically for ethnic women who had between 25% to 100% grain. And mm-hmm. so they're located in New York. I was in Mobile, Alabama at the time as a campus president for a career college. But I am a licensed cosmetologist, have been in the profession for over 24 years, more so at the corporate level, but have done all of those, own salons, schools. I currently am an evaluator for one of the accrediting, the largest accrediting body for beauty and barber schools. And so I told her, you know, I thought I could assist her. They were looking for some technician or stylist support with the new product development testing on consumers that fit the parameters that I had mentioned previously. And so long story short, going back and forth with trying to how to accommodate their needs, I happened on a Friday night after work, you know, getting home, winding down. And truth be told, I was just one of those dinosaurs when it came to participating in any manner on social media, even though I had a Facebook page. Mm-hmm. And so periodically I would just, you know, look at my page, and it happened to be that evening I looked at my page and in my newsfeed ran Facebook for Business. So of course that caught my eye. And so I said, what is this? Clicked the link, and basically the rest is history. I literally spent from about 6 p.m. that Friday evening, probably till the next morning, 8 or 9 o'clock, just devouring all the information that Facebook had available for business. And then what I was able, from what I was finding on Facebook, I was also Googling other information on Social Media Today, Social Media Examiner, all these things I was finding out. And so I was like, oh my gosh, I think that I might be able to do this via Facebook, right? So Sunday evening, I just took the chance, put together a PowerPoint presentation on how I felt that I could accommodate their recruitment efforts via social media campaign. I had never even done a campaign. And so I put together the proposal, submitted it, they reviewed it, came back and said yes. Now, mind you, this was a 6-month project that they gave me at $2,000 a month. First time out the gate. And ever since then, I was hooked. Fast forward now, as a result of in that position as campus president, the decision in 2013 was made to close the campus that I was in. Fortunately, at this date, I say fortunately, you know, when you're in the midst of it, it's an unfortunate situation. You're thinking about what is my next? Well, I decided to do some, for the first time ever, I probably did a self-assessment of all of my skill sets, things that I totally enjoyed doing. And of course, I said, well, where's my career? And I'm thinking, well, girl, you've been in the beauty industry for over 20 years. That is a career. So I decided to really hone in and provide support in terms of education and business development and growth for the beauty and barber industry professional in the areas of business and digital and social media marketing. So I chose to come to Atlanta, which is where I'm now located. Had never lived here before. As a matter of fact, in college, I'm a graduate of Florida A&M University School of Business and Industry. Woo-hoo! and I decided to come to Atlanta, which was a place I said I would never come to. And so I did that in August of 2014. And I just said, you know what? I'm going to focus on really building Salon Solutions Group, which is the name of my consultancy agency. And I am going to continue to really delve into digital and social media marketing. And I'm going to specifically provide in that niche area services to the individuals per se. That is who I focus on. However, I also do have some corporate accounts, and I do manage some social media accounts for some small beauty industry companies.
Awesome. Yeah. I can definitely see that playing out as a made-for-TV movie. That's very inspiring. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted since moving to Atlanta? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And okay, it's time to get down to brass tacks. Kind of like marriage, right? When you first fall in love, everything is new and this person can do no wrong. And then you find out that they snore like a dying moose and have all these other quirks. So after you got here to Atlanta, when was the party kind of over? Okay, now it's time to get down to brass tacks.
You know, the party sort of came to life when I realized, and I never thought about this, was how challenging it would be to get the beauty and barber industry professional to understand that while they are masters of a craft, they lack what I term bankable business brilliance. So that's where, for me, I sort of hit a roadblock. Everything was about being this creative genius for them. You know, I mean, you dangle the carrot. And, you know, even in the industry as long, even being a licensed cosmetology instructor and having taught in cosmetology schools and owned my cosmetology school for about 6 years in the early 2000s, clearly, I just didn't give it as much thought as I now look like, you know, hindsight 2020. So the struggle was real. The struggle was like, okay, what is it going to take? Because I'm committed to them. How do I literally get them committed to me? Because this is feast or famine. I only had a small amount of dollars saved up, right? And so with the move, I had to relocate myself, you know, from where I was. I'm literally starting all over. Trying to figure it out. I decided, you know, because I wanted a more robust knowledge of how social media played into digital marketing, I took a 10-week course through Emory University and got a certificate in web content management along with digital, because I wanted to also understand, you know, when you begin to talk about Google Analytics and websites and things like that, while I am not your back-end person, I do understand the design, web content management, you know, the marriage between Google Analytics and activities and SEO and all of that. So I felt that that would really help me bring another element of support to the beauty industry professional. So what I decided to do in the disenchantment part, now really, this is from 2014, I'm just really now in the last 6 months getting my groove where I'm getting the accounts. I've now sort of broken through to the beauty industry professional, but how I did it was through live. Periscope was my savior.
I love that.
Yeah, it really was. Periscope, and when I found out about Periscope, I could not believe how many people were shying away from this opportunity to get your face. And that was what my dilemma was, is how do I reach the masses even on a limited budget when I'm not bringing in revenue, right?
Right.
So, and then trying to get my own website up and brand my business and do all of those things that I am now working with others on. And so it was, Periscope gave me the opportunity just to operate where I was. When you saw Carla real and raw, right where she was. And so it allowed people to connect with me, as they say, in a very authentic and real manner. Okay, some days Carla was cute. Some days Carla was just Carla, no makeup, no nothing. But what was important to me is that they really got to see the real Carla. Who would they be doing business with? How do I gain their trust and the credibility? And it was just showing up every day. It was providing information to them. It was getting them to see that while they were excellent in their craft, this is what's really missing to elevate your business, and it's the business element. And then I had to figure out how to give them the information in a manner that they would gravitate to and really connect with.
You can't see me over here, but I'm smiling ear to ear like the Cheshire cat. Just got the biggest grin, because the thing I love most about your story is that you went back and you invested in some training and you got the fundamentals in that 10-week course, because I actually have a bachelor's degree in internet marketing. And I think it's so unfortunate how a lot of people sort of poo-poo the fundamentals or going back and getting that certificate or a degree, and they just sort of flounder on Google unnecessarily. So that's really, really powerful. So if you had a time machine and you can go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things that you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
Education is important, okay? Whether it's formal, informal, you can't go without it. Right. It is first and foremost. So first and foremost, look for those who have the information that you don't, that you desire, okay? Be open to admit what you don't know, because all of this faking it till you make it, oh no, you could be like evicted and car repossessed with that mindset.
Exactly.
So don't be afraid. Move the pride aside and just admit when you need help and ask for it. And the third one is to find like-minded people. Find those people who are aspiring just like you, or who have been where you are coming through. Because I think a lot of times, you know, people talk about networking, meaning, oh, let's just be everywhere all the time. And I realized, no, let's be strategic about who I want to connect with and where can I find them. And then bring your true authentic self to them, because I think people are more inclined to provide support when they really know the real you and where you are.
I tend to agree. So now I'm going to ask you to look forward into the future, because one of the things in digital marketing that I follow is mobile and the Internet of Things and connected devices. And sort of that, you know, pat answer that everybody gives is, or example that everybody gives, is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered to you via Amazon drone. Right. And so in that scenario, they call that a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house. And some people are concerned, like, OK, are marketers going to actually have a job when we really do live like the Jetsons? So what's your take on that whole futuristic scenario? Do you and what do you think marketing will look like then?
You know what? I actually believe, and I was a Jetson baby. So, you know, the boomer. Right. And and I have said the very same thing. I said, we laughed at the Jetson, but we are now entering into the Jetson arena here. Our life is like that. Everything about us. Funny you should ask that, is Mark Cuban. I listened to Mark Cuban talk about in 10 years from now, what will be the jobs? What should people, you know, where, who will have the jobs? And the thing about it is, the space for the marketer, I think what is going to happen is, we will always need the marketers, but what the marketers, especially what I call the traditional marketers, you know, some of the companies who are slow to jump on the bandwagon of digital and social media marketing, Let me tell you something. That's why I created the Boom-lennial terminology, even phrase for myself, is because I'm open to the change. I'm open to understanding that people are, you know, I mean, mobile is going to be the way. Yes, marketers are going to have to learn to adapt. And I think, too, is we will have, marketers will change in terms of moving more into the digital arena. It's just going to happen. I think the traditional concepts are still going to be the foundation. We're just going to have a new medium and a new tool, new tools, how we deliver and connect and communicate the message to the audience, to the consumer.
Absolutely. I could not agree more. In our book, Beyond Buzzwords, we in the mobile chapter, we talk about the three ways that businesses grow. And they're just three. That's to get new customers, get existing customers to spend more, or get existing customers to spend more often. And out of those three, mobile is exquisite at the latter two. Yeah. And so even though we're talking about these business concepts within the context of mobile, those actual business concepts themselves, they've literally been teaching that in business school for 100 years. Like they were teaching that at Harvard, like back when James Cash Penney opened the first JCPenney department store. So the fundamentals are fundamental for a reason. They're not going anywhere, even if the face of it changes. So that was spectacular. You have been given some great answers. We are going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Carla Jones. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Carla, you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, a Brian Solis or whoever, you're all sitting at the bar after a conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Okay, and I'm not sure if this is where you're going, but I have had this conversation where I feel, and not to make it an ethnic thing, but I think it is. I'm going to just, for me, it's an elephant in the room, right? I'm going to wake it up. Is I don't think as African-Americans that we believe this is the wave of the future. I think from a technology standpoint, the jobs that we have that we know in this, not just for African Americans, but when I look at tech jobs, when I look in the digital and social media marketing space, I'm not seeing a lot of people like me. I'm right. not really seeing a lot of them who are embracing it as the wave of the future. Even with my peers, even with my colleagues, they're like, oh, it's not going anywhere. Or people are, you know, corporations, I've got friends that are vice president of corporations who are saying, well, I don't have $300,000 in my budget. What are you talking about? Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not getting it. But I think we're in the future. What would I say? Or what would be in my mastermind? Oh, my gosh. From a technology standpoint.
No, you just said it. I tend to agree, and I'm on much the same bandwagon because while we are consumers of the technology, yeah. if you look at a lot of these conferences and if you look at a lot of these agencies, we're just not there. I've been to conferences where I was one of five, and there are literally 600 people in the room.
Absolutely.
So yeah, that's a problem, and it needs to be addressed, and we have to figure out, and we really need to be better at, you know, saying that this is here, it's not going anywhere, and we need to invest in the education. So you hit the nail on the head, and I can't agree more. So without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, express yourself. What's your take on the whole fake news controversy after the 2016 election with regard to fake news? And just to define some terms for those of you who might not know, in the last 3 months of the 2016 election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, we mean these stories were wholesale fabricated and had no factual basis whatsoever. It wasn't a simple matter of spinning the facts in one direction or another. There were no facts to be spun. Like they were fairy tales. They were completely made up. And after that, Facebook has come out and said that they're going to crack down on fake news. And this has sparked a really interesting debate in the digital marketing space because you have some people who are straight First Amendment and they're like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And other people are like, Facebook is a digital platform. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool. And one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property and you are ultimately responsible. So where do you fall on the whole fake news controversy?
In relation to the platform, I totally feel that any business that has the power to influence has a responsibility with what they allow and what they actually put in front of consumers. So I do believe that. I don't think it's a violation. I think it's responsible maintenance or responsible to whatever the platform, and it's Facebook or if it's, you know, LinkedIn, anywhere you host it or allow the information, I think you do owe the consumers, your audience, some sense of protection against things that aren't real, given the fact that we know a lot of people will take everything they read as true. And so for me, I'm one of those people that says, just because it looks like a duck and sounds like a duck, I need to check that puppy out. You know, it could be that dog in that, you know, in a duck's outfit. We need to check it out. And so, but I do believe there is responsibility. I don't think it's a violation of the First Amendment. They're not saying what you can. Well, in essence, they're saying we want the truth. Okay. I don't think Facebook or any other platform has to allow things that are not the truth that they know could have a negative impact on a global scale. I think they have some responsibility there. You know, I really do. That would just be like us having a business and we know that while we have canned goods, we know some of those canned goods aren't good and we still sell it.
Right.
Yeah. So
I agree.
I see that in the same vein. I mean, you know, the platforms have mega influence, as we can see. Okay. People are using the platform for every reason, good, bad, or indifferent, suicide, birth of baby, you know, new jobs, announcements. I don't know what to eat. So can somebody tell me where to go? Where's the best, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I think when it comes to something as serious as things that impact the world, our political stance or even candidates, I think places like Facebook do have a responsibility just to say, you know what? We understand that you're having fun, but our nation, this in an environment where we're talking about the future of our country, yeah, we don't need fake news. I think they have a responsibility to sort of vet the information that's being put out for that purpose. Now, if I want to put up something that's not real and it's a joke, that's fine. But when you're talking about something that influences our nation, the way we operate, how we vote, I think absolutely we need to. Facebook has to say, not here.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So large corporations are really just now starting to put some muscle behind digital marketing. And not that they have adopted it as fervently as traditional marketing, especially depending on the vertical. If it's a B2B space, at least now a lot of places have a marketing department or a position, whereas as recently as 5-6 years ago, they didn't even have that. But that digital ad spend in terms of corporate dollars are disproportionately going to Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. Those two platforms are getting the bulk of the corporate digital ad spend. And of course, the laws of supply and demand dictate that as more corporate dollars flow into the platform with limited ad inventory, that the prices are going to rise. And we have been seeing those clicks become more expensive. So do you think that we'll see a time in the future where social media kind of gets taken over by corporations, or do you think the internet will remain open and free where the small guys can still perform and not get muscled out?
I'll start it this way, and I think it's the same thing that happened to Blab. Okay. Mm-hmm. I think when we look at that, regardless how smart you are, you have to have some way to generate revenue. Okay, businesses don't stay in business without a revenue stream. Right. And so one of the things that I do believe is, I'm going to just say, I take my hats off to Mark Zuckerberg, because he doesn't have to be first, but when he comes out taking over. Right. So I just think what we have to do in the little person, even myself working with smaller companies, has to look at how do we leverage the assets of the platform in the space that we can afford without saying, I still think it's going to be a huge pay for play. It's going to shift. I think somehow that Mark is looking at, I don't think from a, if I just hone in on Facebook, because that is the number one platform for me. I think for those who just still consider the platform social, I think that's a misnomer that people really need to take a look at. Yes, it started out as a social platform and a way we engage and connect with others. But even in the personal page, and to be honest, I now have transitioned some communication and who I connect with on my personal page only to those in the beauty industry.
Right.
Right. So I'm looking at how do I leverage my connection with my direct audience. I think we have to start getting smarter in how we're engaging with what we have available to us that is a non-paid, and understanding how to leverage that as it grows. Now, of course, the larger dollars, the corporations, they are going to fight. Ad space is going to go up. And for those of us who can't invest to that degree, we are going to have to look at how do we still, again, leverage that platform and the resources we have, along with the assets, to connect with our audience. Do I think it's going to cut us totally out? No, but I do think that we're going to have to be more in tune. We're going to have to think ahead of the game and just look at the ways that we can continue to leverage the platform for our benefit. Because, you know, just like someone said, and I don't know, remember where I heard this, is the idea of building the fence or the wall, right? The idea of building the wall. And I heard somewhere is like, well, what difference does it make? Because if you build a 10-foot wall, you only need an 11-foot ladder.
Right.
So there's still going to be an opportunity for the small people to play. I think we're just really going to have to be very smart. And as we say, learn hacks that work for us and our clients.
I like that analogy. If you build a 10-foot wall, you only need an 11-foot ladder. I dig that. So last question, I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time. And I am going to take just a few moments to set it up because it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. But I'm going somewhere very specific with it. And I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So in both my personal and professional opinion, there's a severe gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a corporation or at an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you can absolutely make the case that they're professionals because they operate at such a high level. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. And in terms of career path and professionalizing oneself, you one path is you sort of start off meandering the wilds of Google. And while there is some very good information out there, rooting it out does take a little bit of skill. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might land up in Amway. Like, who knows? And so there's no guarantees on Google. You can do what I did, which is go back and get a degree specific to internet marketing, or what you did and go back and take a certification. The problem with that is it's very expensive. My degree program cost the better part of $60,000. Plus, it's time consuming. Even though my degree was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And in the online space, 30 months is, you know, several lifetimes. But by far, the more prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less expensive than a degree program, you have to have that money up front. So take your better conferences like a South by Southwest or a Social Media Marketing World or a MozCon, something like that, an inbound summit. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include the flight, your hotel, Uber, food. Nope, just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all those other things back in, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And so what ends up happening is that a lot of people are in life situations where they just can't swing that. And so you don't tend to see very many people of color in the audiences of these things, going back to your previous elephant in the room. And so I'm trying to figure out a way to professionalize oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to come out of pocket $5,000, which a lot of folks are in life situations where that's just not feasible. So now that I've just got finished rambling for however long, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Carla. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Okay, that's awesome, because it almost is like, wow, that's basically what I had to do, Jesus. Okay. Right. Bottom line is, the best tool that I have are two, computer and a Wi-Fi, okay? Remember, I went back and said I put myself in front of Periscope. Well, I would even do one better. Learn to leverage the influencers that are already in that space. Connect with them first, right? So one of the things that I did is I reached out to Dave Otto. He's the YouTube tech guy, right? So I think at this point, when you're talking about networking, 30 days, no money, you've got to make some powerful connections. So I would identify in my space who were the power hitters that had the influence, the Gary Vee, so to speak, right? Those in a corporate space, even a Mark Cuban, because I mean, I just follow him because, hey, he is in the tech world. He's got some things he's working on. So the thing about it is, I think here's where you really have to get resourceful. You've already got everything taken care for you. So really, at the end of the day, your base, your fundamental life necessities are not a worry. So now you can devote 30 days, 24/7 to making connections. And also, what is your thought leadership on the subjects that you're connecting to? Because what I did on Twitter is I connected to digital marketing influencers. So when they were putting out articles, even though I may not have had the experience to have written on that topic, I have some knowledge, but not theirs. So I would read it, and then I would give some thought leadership on what they wrote about, and I would put it out in the space. I would start saying, totally agree. Or there's another way to look at this. Here, how about this? And get people to start, hey, they're connecting with Carla. They're reaching out to Carla. That's what I actually did. And so I think if you would have said to me, the only thing that you have are all the other things and you don't have a computer and a Wi-Fi, I'm gonna have problems.
Right.
I would not. But that is literally what I tell people. In today's world, and even looking futuristically, if they put me on Mars, Pluto, created or found, I think I saw somewhere and I didn't read the article 2 days ago, there are seven more planets they just uncovered, right? Put me on any one of those seven. Give me, if I've got food, at least there's a food source, okay? I don't care if it's vegetable. Give me something and give me Wi-Fi and a computer. I'm going to make it work. Even if I have to sit there and communicate, because again, somehow I have to be, and I know I'm way out there, right? So I got to, let's just say there are people who live where I live. But even if it was another planet and Earth, as long as I had Wi-Fi in exchange, a way that they could pay me online, okay, and somewhere for it to go for me to access it, I'm good.
I think
that's what you have to have. And so many people think, you know, if I'm not in front of their face, you can be in front of anybody's face. Okay, fine. I can jump on your now with Facebook Live. Oh my gosh, too. I didn't even mention them, but Insta Live, anywhere you can get your face in front of someone right away now. And definitely leveraging influencers communities is a way to go. Become an influencer in an influencer community. How's that? Yeah.
There you go. Carla, this has been absolutely tremendous. I love the energy. I love the fire. Please take a moment. Talk about Salon Solutions Group. Tell us all your social media platforms, anything you got going on. Where can we get some more of you?
All right. Okay. Well, definitely you can get more of me online. I am Carla Jones of Salon Solutions Group. You can find me across the board on all platforms, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, Periscope, at I am Carla Jones. I made it very simple. Website is Salon Solutions Group. And as I stated before, I am what I call a small boutique agency with a niche focus in the beauty and barber industry and the health and beauty industry world. And so basically what I do is I provide business direction, digital and social media marketing strategies, do manage a few, but I say I create customized growth profit strategies for the beauty and barber industry professional. I take them from pain to profit, and by building platforms and systems that help them increase their growth and sustainable business trajectory. And so I do have one program that I just launched. It is a 10-month Business and Digital Beauty Academy for the beauty and barber industry professional. I do have also a closed Facebook group where I do, quote, mentor. It's called We Create, W-E-C-R-E, the number 8-T-E. The 8 represents infinity because we can create infinite opportunities for ourselves. And so my 10-month program, you can actually find that on my website at salonsolutionsgroup.com. And it is called We Create Pro Business and Digital Beauty Academy. And it's exactly what it says. It focuses on the beauty and barber industry professional by providing them business education, very similar to what we went through in college. It's the same fundamentals of business, just applied to their specific needs as a beauty and barber industry professional. And so, again, you can find all the information about that, how to register, landing pages, whatever, on my website at salonsolutionsgroup.com. And so with that being said, that's who I am, what I do, and what I got going on.
SalonSolutionsGroup.com, folks. Go get that if it's in your niche. Carla, this has been tremendous. We greatly appreciate your time.
All right. Thank you so much for the opportunity. And I just look forward to connecting with you in the future.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.